So when it comes to hamstring testing, often we first of all think of the Nordic hamstring exercise and using technology such as VALD Performance NordBord to quantify the force output in this exercise. But actually, there are a lot of different options for us in terms of hamstring strength testing. So today we're going to touch on a few of the different types of tests that we might consider using. Welcome to Global Performance Insights. My name is Jo Clubb and I'm a sports science consultant. Let's start off then briefly talking about that Nordic hamstring exercise test. Now, if you want more information on this, I do have another video that covers the Nordic hamstring exercise strength test on a NordBord in much greater detail. But as a brief overview then, this is a test of eccentric hamstring strength during this knee dominant position, whereby an individual carries out a Nordic hamstring curl, or in some places, this is sometimes referred to as a Russian lean, whereby from a kneeling position, the hips do not change position. We are then leaning forward and extending at the knees. By using technology such as the NordBord then, which has these four cells that can measure the force output through these hooks that are placed around the ankles, we can quantify the force generated by an individual during this exercise. And because we have the left and right hooks, we can also then look at the asymmetry between the left and the right sides. As I mentioned, that exercise is firstly an eccentric muscle contraction and secondly a knee dominant exercise. Now, hamstring muscle injury risk, like any injury risk, is complex. It is not just about a single risk factor. We want to ideally have a well-rounded testing battery with our individuals, whether they are athletes or whether they are patients that you are seeing in a clinic. So what other technologies or tests might be available to us? Now, historically, isokinetic dynamometers have been described as perhaps the gold standard when it comes to measuring the strength, particularly concentric, eccentric strength of different muscle groups. The issue with an isokinetic dynamometer is perhaps the lack of practicality. They are, though, still common in certainly clinic settings and in some cases in the applied setting, and may be used on a more individualized basis because of the level of information that they can collect in terms of force outputs, but also peak torque, as well as working through the different angles in a very controlled manner. Research such as this paper from 2008 has identified both asymmetries measured during isokinetic dynamometry, as well as the ratio between hamstring and quadricep output as potential modifiable risk factors for hamstring injury. But because of those practical issues with the isokinetic dynamometer, research has explored other alternatives, which include handheld dynamometry. So handheld dynamometers certainly improve the practicality and portability of this kind of testing. One thing we have to be really aware of is the reliability, because particularly when they are in these handheld systems, we have to make sure that the methodology that we're using to test our athletes or our patients is repeatable, and therefore the data is reliable, both within a tester. So if I am testing different athletes on different days or the same athlete on different days, am I conducting that test in a reliable manner? But also then between testers. So if they're tested one day by me and another day by a different individual, are we doing that in a reliable manner whereby any difference in their performance is not due to the technology or ourselves as the testers in terms of how we conducted the test? So we see with handheld dynamometry both inter-tester reliability and intra-tester reliability. So here we have one study from the International Journal of Sports Physical Therapy when they assessed the reliability and the validity of a handheld dynamometer for end-range hamstring strength testing. You can see this end-range position here in the figure. And interestingly then, as I mentioned with the isokinetic dynamometer, because this is seen as the gold standard, this is often the technology that is used as a comparison to assess the validity of other technologies. So in this case, there was a significant strong correlation with an R value of 0.87 found between the data collected for the force and the strength measured by a handheld dynamometer compared to that isokinetic dynamometry output. And in terms of the reliability then, this study found excellent intra-rater reliability and good to moderate inter-rater reliability. So that's something to be aware of, particularly in a clinical setting, if perhaps at times there's going to be different people conducting this test on the same patients. And technology is evolving in this area to help improve our validity and reliability. In particular, VALD's Dynamo shows there are really versatile ways now that we can use a dynamometer. They describe it like four devices in one, because as we see here, you have the palm pad, the tension links, the flat pad, and the curved pad. But if you have access to a force plate, then we also probably want to make use of this, because this technology has been described as the gold standard for measuring isometric force. So if you have it available to you, how can we utilize it in our hamstring testing battery? Well, one test that has been gaining interest and I think traction in the applied setting in recent time is the McCall 9090 test. Isometric contractions have or create little to no structural damage, and therefore they can be a valuable way to collect information on our athletes without adding fatigue or stress. So generally these kinds of tests are considered safer and more practical, and therefore becoming an increasing part of monitoring fatigue, monitoring the athlete's readiness status post-competition.
ForceDecks, the world's fastest, easiest, and most powerful dual force plate system. Assess physical performance in seconds. Jump, land, squat, push, pull, and more. ForceDecks automatically analyzes more than 20 common tests. You can even record video, which is automatically synced with your force data. Then find all your data and reports in one place. VALD Hub, including integrated norms based on millions of data points, helping give context to your athlete's results. And it's not just ForceDecks. You'll find all your VALD data in VALD Hub. One login, all of your performance data. Welcome to VALD.
So with the McCall 9090 test, we prop the force plate up on some sort of step or box. And then obviously you want to have that at a consistent height and position every time. It's been recommended by Allen's study to use two positions. Firstly, we have the 90 degree position, so 90 degrees of knee flexion from full knee extension, as well as then a 30 degree position. So in the 90 degree position, the semimembranosus and semitendinosus of the hamstring muscles are maximally activated. Whereas in the position of 30 degrees of knee flexion from full knee extension, the biceps femoris is maximally activated. Although we're trying to simplify our testing, I really like how this has acknowledged the difference, the complexity within the hamstring muscle group, and try and account for those individual muscles within this muscle group. So we have the non-working leg in a relaxed, straight position, ideally under that box or in that step that's not going to interfere at all. And then the working leg is instructed to push down through the heel into the force plate and without lifting up, particularly their butt, because a little bit like our hip and groin testing video where we talked about the athlete's desire to overcome and create more force by lifting up their butt. That is something certainly to look out for in this test, but also in general, no lifting of the shoulders, the head. This is designed to be an isometric contraction, so minimal movement. And in this study, analyzing the reliability of this test, Allen and his colleagues found that there was good to high reliability with coefficients of variation between around 4 to 6% and the ICC around 0.86 to 0.95. So they concluded that this test then was reliable and it was sensitive to change. Thereby, it can detect meaningful changes in fatigue status after a game. And then we do have an alternative again to force plate testing, whereby we can actually make use of our NordBord, not just for the Nordic hamstring exercise. So VALD previously put out a post here demonstrating a number of different positions in which you can conduct isometric hamstring testing on the NordBord. Much like the McCall 9090, this shows the different positions and thereby the different muscle angles in which we can test our individuals. So if they are earlier on in their rehab post-injury, we may have limitations on the range with which we can go to. So we might want to start off in a more inner range position, such as this ISO 60 degree position. Then we can progress through, perhaps we'd be interested in a 30 degree position, and then as well a prone position at 0 degrees of knee flexion. And as I have talked about throughout this whole series with VALD Performance, talking about all the different athlete tests, we have to conduct it in a consistent manner using consistent protocols and cues. So how long are you cueing the athlete for? What instructions are you giving them? These are all really important methodological considerations. So make sure you're taking that into account when you're conducting these tests in your setting. Thank you for watching. I hope you found this video useful. If you did, then definitely have a look at the rest of the athlete testing series, which I'll put a link to that playlist below so you can explore all the different tests that we've talked about in this series. And I will see you again soon for another Sports Science Insights video.